Hello people, welcome to Gurukula. I'm Jai. So today in this video we are going to start our new module in our communication network series. So we are going to start our third module, which we are going to cover completely about routing. So without any further ado, let's get into the topic. So this module, particularly this routing module, covers the concepts of routing, and then we will be talking something about unicast routing and then the multicast routing, and then we will see what are all the various algorithms and various protocols that is associated to unicast and as well as multicast routing, and we will throw some light on what's intra-domain and inter-domain routing protocols and what are all the associated algorithms for it. And finally, we will be discussing what is IPv6 and how is it IPv6 represented, and also what is the procedure for transition from IPv4 to IPv6. So these are all the various points which is planned to cover in this particular module. So first we will try to understand which layer is responsible for routing. So you very well know that the layer that is responsible for routing is the network layer. So the prime functionality of the network layer is end-to-end delivery of IP packets. So if you assume that this node is the source node and this node is the destination node, if at all the system or the network wants to transfer the packets from source to destination, it will has to hop from one node to the another node. So first of all, it will go from here to here, and later on it will go from here to here, and finally it will be delivered to here to here. So the hopwise delivery is what will happen in a network. And this particular node-to-node delivery is what we call it as hop-to-hop delivery, and this will be entirely taken care by a layer in OSI model. We call that as data link layer. So whereas in our previous module we completely discussed about the data link layer and what are all the various sub layers of data link layer and what are all the various functionalities of all the data link layer properties is concerned. So if you have not yet watched the previous videos, I will leave the description in the I button and as well as link in the description section. Please do check the previous videos related to the data link layer as well. So now coming back to the topic. So now the entire source to destination delivery will be taken care by the layer called the network layer. So this is what the primary function of the network layer. And then the routing, in order to understand the process of routing, to be put it in a very basic explanationary view, we can say that the routing is the process of selecting a path from traffic in network or between or across multiple networks. So routing is nothing but it is a process of selecting a path for a packet to travel correctly from source to destination. So in order to do this process effectively, we need to understand the three principles behind the routing process. The first principle is delivery, and the second principle is forwarding, and the third principle is routing itself. So we will discuss what all these three principles are in one by one. So first we will try to understand what exactly the delivery is. So as the picture depicts, delivery is nothing but it is handing over the packets to the next person or the neighbor. Here in network scenario, we call it as handling of packets by the network. So handling of packets is nothing but it is delivering the packets to the neighboring nodes. So as you can see, the delivery can be done in two ways. So first way is the direct delivery, where you can see in the figure very clearly that the packet will be directly delivered to the destination. And whereas in case if the source and then the destination, or in other words the sender and then the receiver, is way far apart, then obviously we need to deliver the packets with the help of intermediate persons. So we will be delivering the packets to the intermediate person, and then by keep on delivering the packet to the immediate next node, and finally the packet will be reached to the final destination node. So that is the second type of delivery. We call it as indirect delivery. So now we will see where exactly the direct delivery will happen and where exactly indirect delivery will happen. So direct delivery will take place when the source and then the destination falls in the same network. So if the source and destination falls on the same network, then we can happily implement direct delivery of packets. And indirect delivery will take place if the source and then the destination falls on different physical networks. So if the source and destination falls on different networks, then indirect delivery will be taking place. And in more fortunately or unfortunately, in practical situations or in real-time situations, most of the networks do not have a direct delivery concepts, or it is not possible for us to have a point-to-point link between source and then the destination all over to all the nodes. So most of the time we will be having indirect delivery, and then sometimes we will have direct delivery. So when do we have direct delivery and when do we have indirect delivery will be very clear when you look into this particular figure. So these two figures will clarify you what is indirect delivery and what is direct delivery is concerned. So when you look at this figure depicts what is direct delivery. So as you can see, this is what the host that is receiving the packets. So as you can see, the packet is being sent from the host which is connected to this particular network, and it is sending to the another host which is also connected to the same network. So if the packet delivery is happening from one host to another host within a network, and we call that as the direct delivery. And also, if the packet is coming from the outside network, but this particular router is connected to the same network. So no matter whether the host is delivering the packet or the router is delivering the packet, if this particular host receives the packet from the devices connected to the same network, then we can call that as direct delivery. As you can observe that even this is what we call it as direct delivery from host, and even from the router we call it as direct delivery. I hope you will be very clear with what direct delivery is. Now we will throw some light on what's indirect delivery. So coming to this particular figure, you can see this figure depicts both indirect and as well as the direct delivery of packets. So as you can see, this is what our source is. Our source is connected to this particular network, and then our destination is connected to this particular network. It is very clear that the source and then the destination is connected by two different networks, and these two different networks are connected together using an intermediate router. So if my packet wants to reach from the source to destination, then obviously my packet has to travel to this particular router and from this router to this particular destination. So that is how my packet can reach the destination. So this particular source to this particular node, say for an example, from source to router, this delivery is what we call it as indirect delivery, because the recipient is not the actual receiver of that particular packet. So that is what we call it as indirect delivery. And when it comes to the second hop, when you observe this particular hop, you can clearly see that this router is also connected to this network, and then we are trying to deliver a packet to the host which is also connected to the same network. So no matter this particular host is receiving from another host, or it is connecting from, or it is getting packet from the device which is connected to the same network, we call that as direct delivery. So in a sum up, we can say that there will be only one direct delivery that is happening on a network, and there may be multiple number of indirect deliveries. So you can have any number of indirect deliveries happening on a network, and you will have only one direct delivery happening in that particular network. So now it will be very clear about what is exactly the delivery is. To keep it simple, delivery is nothing but it is like handing over the packet to the neighboring node. If the neighboring node is actually the destination, then we call it as direct delivery. And if the neighboring node is not an actual receiver of that particular packet, we call it as indirect delivery. It is as simple as that. So with this information about delivery, we will further proceed to understand what exactly the second process is. So the second process is forwarding. So what is exactly forwarding? So in order to understand the concept of what forwarding is, what I will do is I will take an infrastructure that most of the engineering institutions will have, or at least our engineering institutions will have this kind of setup. So I will first of all explain what this setup is, and then we will try to understand how a message is being forwarded to the exact destination. So here we have an HOD. So let us take that this is an HOD of EC department where I belong to. And then their HOD will be taking care of the 3 years of the course, second year, third year, and then the final year is concerned. So HOD has been appointed 3 persons to take care of individual year. And here in our case, we call it as year coordinators. So this person will be taking care of the entire conduct of the second year, and this person will be taking care of the entire conduct of third year, and this person will be taking care of the entire conduct of the final year or the fourth year. And then each and every year coordinator is being assigned with many number of advisors. Let it be one advisor per section. If there is three advisors, if there is three sections, we will have 3 advisors. You can call it as class advisors, you can call them as class in charges, or you can call them as class mentors, or whatever it may be. But as of now, in our example, I used to use the name class advisors. So let us assume that there are 2 sections under each and every year, and then we have 2 advisors over here. So let us say he is for A section, and let us say he is in charge for the B section. And the same way, it is applicable for the other 2 years as well. And then the class advisors will be connected to the representatives of the students community. This is what we call it as the students community. Here is where we have the second year students, and all the second year students will be represented by one particular person. We call this blue person as the representative. So advisors will be passing any information to this particular representative, and this representative will in turn forward the messages to the entire students group, those who are studying in the second year. And the same setup is applicable for all the remaining years as well. Now I guess that you will be very clear with the infrastructure, and now let us try to understand what exactly this forwarding is. So now let us take that we have a principal over here, and the principal is sending some message over here to HOD, and this message says that the third year A section students, so the third year A section students need to attend a meeting in the seminar hall in next 2 hours of time or some other day. So a meeting is scheduled for third year A section students. That is what the message which is passed to HOD, and HOD is requested to intimate this message to the students. So however, this particular message should reach the third year students, and not the all third year students. We were interested to pass this message only to the third year A section students. So how is it being forwarded? So first of all, the HOD will receive the message, and the HOD will check the contact list. So he will have a list of contacts where the year coordinator's number will be there. So second year coordinator, third year coordinator, and then the final year coordinator. And HOD very well knows that, and this particular contact list will have their contact numbers. Fine. And HOD very well knows that this particular information is related to third years. So this message should be forwarded to third year coordinator. So he will be selecting this particular entry, and then he will be forwarding this message or a circular only to this particular contact who is in charge of third year. Right. Now coming to the third year. So third years will have again a contact list. In their contact list, he will have the class advisor number of A section and class advisor number of B section. So the phone numbers will be over here, and then this message will be carefully forwarded to the third year. So when looking at the message, he says that this particular circular is intended for third year A section students. So third year A section students, their person who is responsible for third year A section is class advisor of A section. So this particular message will be forwarded to this particular contact or this particular person. So he will be selected, and then the message will be forwarded to this particular person. Right. And when we look into the contact details of this particular third year class advisor, you can see the representative numbers of that particular A section. So representative of A section will be there, and then their contact number will be there. So A section class advisor will carefully select the contact number of this particular class, which means our A section in our example is concerned, and then the message will be forwarded to this particular representative, and this message is reached or it is delivered to the class representative of third year A section class representative, and third year A section class representative will in turn will be connected to all the students group, and then the message will be disseminated to all the students of third year A section alone and not the B section, right? So this is how the message will be forwarded from the source to destination. So here in our case, we call this principal as the source of information who actually initiated the packet transfer. Here packet, we can equate that to a circular which he sent. And then the destination people are, this is where we call it as the destination. And in our case, third year A section students were the destination where the packet has to be delivered. So this is how, when you clearly observe this particular scenario, each and every layer, they are referring to a special type of list or special type of table, and that table is what we call it as the routing table. Only with the help of that particular table, they are deciding the packet should be delivered where I have to forward that particular packet. So HOD cannot directly have all the entries or all the phone numbers of third year students. There might be 200, 300 students studying in a particular department, and we cannot expect a HOD to have all the entries. And of course, he can have entry whenever it is a situation to pass a message. When there are more number of entries, then HOD has to really struggle to find out a particular entry on it. So here, the key point which I am trying to drive over here is each and every person who is trying to forward a message to the next stage will have some sort of list in his particular memory. Here in our example, we said it is a contact list. But when it comes to real-time environment, the same setup may be seen over here. So the data will be sent or the data will be initiated from the server. We can call the server as the source, and then the client, we call it as a destination. So if there is any information which has to be flown from source to the destination, then obviously it is not possible to have a point-to-point connection from source to the destination. So we will have many intermediate nodes, as like we have seen in our example is concerned, and then each and every router will also have a special type of table which will be referred in order to forward the packets in the correct direction. And this table, this special table which is helping the router to forward the messages in the correct direction, is what we call it as routing table. So forwarding means to place the packet in its route to its destination. So forwarding requires definitely a host to have a routing table. So here in our case, it can be a host or it can be a router, but in most of the typical situations, only the routers will have the routing table. So what do you mean by the routing table? It has a list of entries, or it will have many number of entries which will help the router to decide on which direction the packet has to be forwarded. So that is what we call it as routing table, which can be equated to our contact list. So when a host has a packet to send, or when a router has received a packet which has to be forwarded to any destination, first of all, it will look into the table to find in which route the packet has to be forwarded to reach the correct destination. And when it has more number of entries in the table, we must be very particular about how many number of entries can be there in the routing table also. So this particular slide brings us the importance of the routing table. So when we try to understand the process of forwarding, this is where exactly the point where the routing table comes into the picture. So now you come across a new word which is related to routing, that is what we call it as routing table. Fine, I hope it will be clear so far. Now for the forwarding, now discussing about the number of entries in the routing table. We cannot have more number of entries in the routing table. So what happens if we have more number of entries in the routing table? If at all I have to look up for a particular entry, it will take a longer time if I have more number of entries in the routing table. And at the same time, I cannot have very less number of entries in the routing table as well. If that is the case, then I may end up in insufficient data and I cannot able to route the packet in the correct direction. I may miss some useful informations or I may miss some useful contacts. Right? So in this case, it is clear, it is very important to understand that we cannot have more number of entries or we cannot have very less number of entries as well. So if at all I should not have more number of entries and as well as I should not have very less number of entries. So what should a router do? How number of entries can be decided without affecting the routing process? That is very important. So this is where actually forwarding techniques comes into the picture. There are certain forwarding techniques which is incorporated in the routing process which will help us to form a routing table with optimum number of entries in the table without affecting the routing process. So these are all the four forwarding techniques which is being incorporated. So the main objective of this forwarding techniques are, as discussed already, are to reduce the number of entries in the routing table and importantly without affecting the routing process. So the number of entries in the routing table should not affect the routing process at any point in time. So these are all the four techniques what we have, and then we have root method, we have next hop method, and we have host specific method, or we have network specific method. Now we will quickly visit all these methods and then we will see an example of routing table which is created by using all these four types of forwarding techniques, and then we will see how the routing table is becoming more efficient by using this forwarding techniques. So first of all, we will discuss, we will take two methods at a time and then we will side by side compare it. So we will have the next hop method and then we will have the root method. Out of these two methods, we call it as next hop method is more advantageous. Why are we saying that the next hop method is more advantageous? Because that will have an optimal number of entries in the routing table. And remember, we should not have more number of entries and as well as we should not have less number of entries. So keeping this in mind, we will try to understand how next hop method is very, very effective. So in this technique, the routing table holds only the address of the next hop details. I know it is very difficult for you to read the theoretical part. So without wasting much of your time, I will take you to the graphical representation of this particular method. So which will help you to understand the concepts very clearly. So when you look at this particular figure, you can have two tables. So this routing table is generated. These routing tables is generated based on the root method. And then the set of routing tables represented over here is developed based on next hop method for the network that is represented over here. As you can look at the network, you can see there is an host A. Here we will be calling host A as the source node and we will be calling this host B as the destination node. So if at all I want to transfer a packet from source to the destination, then how the packet will get transferred? And most obviously, we very well know that the first hop should be R1. So this should be R1 and from R1 it should be to R2 and from R2 it should be delivered to the host. So this is what the route that my packet will take as far as example is concerned. Now let us see how the routing tables are formed. So first of all, we will take this particular routing table which is created by using root method. So this is the routing table for host A. So what does the entries have? It has the entire route to reach the destination. So in order to reach host B, this particular routing table has the complete route to reach the host B. It has to travel to R1, it has to travel to R2, it has to travel host B finally. So this is having more number of entries, right? And similarly, when you look at the routing table for R1, which is generated by using root method, you can see that in order to reach host B from R1, the route which you have to take is R2 and then you will have to reach host B. And then R2 is directly connected to host B so that it can be directly delivered. So it can be clearly viewed from this particular table that it is carrying the entire route to reach the particular destination. But whereas in the other side, we have the routing tables, which is developed based on the next hop method. In next hop method, you will have only the entries of the next immediate node which my packet has to reach. So here, when you take, this is the routing table for host A, but this time it is developed by using next hop method. So what is the difference? So host B, in order to reach host B, my routing table says that the packet has to be forwarded to R1. That's all, nothing more than that. I don't have any entries apart from R1, right? So host B, it is enough to know only where I have to forward the packet. Once the packet reaches R1, the routing table of R1 will be checked. So here, once it reaches R1, then the routing table of R1 will be verified. So what's there in the routing table of R1? So R1 routing table says that in order to reach host B, the packet has to be forwarded to R2. So the packet will be forwarded to R2. And once I have reached R2, I will be checking the routing table of R2, and R2 routing table says that host B is connected in the same network. So I need not forward the packet in any network condition. So what it will do, it will be directly delivered to this particular host. So when you look at the number of entries over here, even here, next hop method, the forwarding is happening seamlessly, and at the same time, the number of entries over here is also very, very optimum as compared to your root method. Whereas in root method, the same forwarding happens, but still we have more number of entries which will take more time to look up. And it also, it will consume more amount of space to store this particular routing table. So we can conclude that the next hop method is more advantageous than the root method in framing the routing table. So we also have the other two techniques to compare, which is network specific method and as well as host specific method. So I know you will be very bored to look at this particular text. Let me get into the graphical representation and we will try to understand what is the difference between the network specific method and as well as the host specific method. So now this time, this is what the network where I have to transfer the packet, and S acts as the source, and then this N2, all the host that is connected to N2 acts as the destination. So if at all, let us see the routing table that is generated for this particular host alone. So this particular routing table is generated based on host specific method, and this particular routing table is generated based on network specific method. So let's take for an example that this method, if you can clearly see that this particular method is developed based on the host specific. As you can see, that address of each and every host is represented over here. So if at all I have to transfer a packet to a host A, then I will have to forward my packet to R1. And if at all I have to transfer my packet to B, I will have to forward to R1. So similarly, the other two cases as well. So any systems, let it be A, B, C or D, I will have to forward the packet to the same router R1. So which means I am going to, or this particular node is going to transfer the packet to the same network, whatever be the destination is, until and unless it is connected to the same network. Right, so this is what the routing table, which is created based on the host specific method, and you can clearly see that there are four number of entries which is required to successfully deliver the packet from source to destination. And whereas on the other side, you can see the routing table which is generated based on network specific method. So here, instead of having host, we will be very specific about the network. So as you can see, instead of having the entries of A, B, C and D, we can have the network ID over here, which means the address of this particular network will be represented over here. So if a particular source wants to transfer any information to this particular network, obviously I need to send my information to R1. So that is what represented over here. So in these two cases, the routing will happen seamlessly, but the advantages is at the side of the network specific method. Or in other words, I can say that the network specific method has an upper hand because it is enabling the seamless routing with the less number of entries in the routing table. So we can conclude that the network specific method is more advantageous as compared to the host specific method. So apart from these four forwarding techniques, we also have something called as default method, where the default method will be used when I very well know that the router R1 is connected only to one particular network. So any traffic which is destinated to network 2 alone will be forwarded to R1, and all other traffic whatever I generate from network 1 and any other network has to be reached, it has to be forwarded to router 2. So this is what we call it as the default method. Whereas in case if there is any traffic that is generated or it is destinated to N2, I will have to forward my packets to R1, and apart from that all other packets should take the default route. So here the default route is to R2, which is connecting to the rest of the internet. So this method is what we call it as the default method. So now you very well know about what is a routing table and what are all the various techniques that we implement to decide the number of entries in the routing table without affecting the routing process. So what will be there in the routing table? So if you check what are all the various methods that will be there in the routing table, you can clearly see that. So we have these many entries in the routing table. So you have network ID, so you have the cost, and you will have the next hop. So this is a sample routing table which can be kept for the reference. So routing table can be formed in two types. So how do we form the routing table? We can form the routing table in two different ways. So one is the static routing and another one is the dynamic routing table. So now we will see when static routing table can be used and when dynamic routing table can be used. So static routing table contains information which are manually entered, so which will be prepared by an administrator. So the system administrator or the network administrator is the person who actually enters the route for each and every destination into the table. So this particular table will be acting as a routing table, which is what created as a static routing table. So when a table is created, it cannot update automatically because it was created manually. So we cannot expect that particular table to be updated manually. So when we need to change the table, if at all there is any change in the network, let's take for an example, if the router is down or if the link has gone down, if there is any problem, it's say for an example, the particular route to the destination is over traffic and there is a congestion experienced in the network. So all these types of situations will require to reroute the traffic. So this will not happen automatically when we create routing table in a static form. So a static routing table cannot be used for bigger networks such as internets. So what can we do for bigger kind of networks? So if we have to develop a routing table for a bigger kind of network such as internet, then we have no other option left out. We will have to go for the other type of routing mechanism, that is what we call it as dynamic routing table. So what makes the difference between static routing table and dynamic routing table? So the routers in a big internet such as internet needs to be updated dynamically for every changes happening in the network. So a dynamic routing table is updated periodically when and where there is a change in the internet that is happening. So if I call a change, it can be a shutdown of a router or it can be breakage of the link. So in any of these cases, the router needs to update the table automatically. There should not be any intervention of human being. Human being I refer to as system admin or the network administrator to intervene the process, and they should not update the routing table. It should happen automatically. So whenever I say automatically in the field of computer science, it will not happen automatically. We will have to teach the system or the network how to do it. So we cannot do it randomly, that we must follow certain protocols and then the algorithms. So this is where the place actually the routing algorithm and then the routing protocols are getting into the picture. So now we have thrown enough light on the concepts of the routing is concerned. So we tried to understand what exactly the routing is. So we have came to the summary of this particular session. So we have started our session to understand what exactly the routing process is. In order to understand the routing process very clearly, you will have to understand three principles separately. The first principle is delivery, the second principle is forwarding, and the third principle is routing itself. So first, when we talk about delivery, it talks about how do we hand over the packets to the neighboring node. So delivery can be done in two ways. One is direct delivery and other one is indirect delivery. So direct delivery happens when the source and destination are located in the same network, and indirect delivery will happen when the source and then the destination is located at two different physical networks. So that's all about delivery part. And looking into the forwarding technique, so we have taken an example of architecture or an hierarchy level that is happening in an educational institution, and we just try to understand how the forwarding is being done. And we very well came to a solution, and we very well know that the forwarding can be done only with the help of the routing table. So if at all it comes to routing table, then we should have a perfect balance on the number of entries in the routing table as well. So how do we decide the number of entries in the routing table without affecting the routing process? We have certain forwarding techniques that we have discussed. So what are all the routing techniques that we discussed? We first started with the root method and then the next hop method, and then we found that the next hop method is more effective than the root method, because the next hop method has very less entry in the routing table as compared to the root method, and also without affecting the routing process. And the second set of forwarding techniques that we discussed is the host specific method and as well as the network specific method. And even here we concluded that the network specific method is more advantageous as compared to the host specific method, whereas even here the network specific method had very less number of entries in the routing table and without affecting the routing process. And in addition to all these four techniques, we also discussed another technique we call that as default forwarding techniques. And then later case, we will have to understand the principle of routing itself. So how the routing table is being formed? It can be formed in two ways. One is the static routing table and another one is dynamic routing table. So static routing table, it will be developed by system administrator and it cannot able to adapt itself for the varying environment. So that is why we always go for the dynamic routing table. So if we go for dynamic routing table, it has the capability of adapting to the varying environment. Whenever if there is any change that is occurring in the network, then it could able to change its routing table automatically. So when I say automatically, then obviously we need to tell them what to do and how to do. So obviously we need the help of algorithms and then the protocols, and this is where the place where exactly the routing algorithms and then the routing protocols comes into the picture, or this is the right point where we need to take the routing algorithms and then the routing protocols for further discussions. And obviously you guessed it right, the next topic is going to be the routing algorithms and then the routing protocol. So we will be taking each and every algorithms that is involving in the routing procedure, and we will be discussing how each and every routing algorithms and protocols are working for it. So that's it all about for today's particular video, and I'm going to see you in the next video. Until then, it's bye from Jay and happy learning.